IVM.
Hi guys, unfortunately we couldn't record a new episode of Know Your Kanoon this week. So instead we are rebroadcasting an earlier episode. We hope you'll enjoy the show. Please listen in.
Hi and welcome to Know Your Kanoon. This is Amber from Corpus Legal. And in today's episode, continuing our journey with consumer protection and the rights of consumers under the Consumer Protection Act, we are going to see and describe how to approach the consumer protection rules, the laws, the helplines, and what is the definition of a consumer under the Act, and what are the different authorities enunciated, and what can one do to relieve himself of any atrocity being committed by any of the service providers. For us to approach the authorities for deficiency of services, we must have a clear understanding of what eventually a consumer is and who is a consumer, who can actually approach the authorities. So as per the Act, the definition is pretty clear and evident. It says that a consumer is a person who purchases a product or avails a service for a consideration, either for his personal use or to earn his livelihood by means of self-employment. Alright, so in these situations, this has to be the preliminary starting point to realize whether you are a consumer or not. Alright, the consideration in these situations, as I enunciated, would be the consideration may be paid, promised, partly paid and partly promised. The definition of consumer shall also include a beneficiary of such goods and services when such use is made with the approval of such person. And now let's look at, who is not a consumer? When can you not approach the respective authorities? It would be a person is not a consumer as per the Act if he or she purchases any goods or avails services free of charge, purchases a good or hires a service for commercial purposes, avails any service under contract of service, does nothing, which falls under the purview of personal use or immediately affecting us, would not constitute a consumer as per the definition of the Consumer Protection Act. Thus, it is imperative that either of the conditions which I mentioned in the beginning of the show need to be complied with in order to avail the relief under the Act. What I would like to bring to the notice of the our listeners is, the contract of service and contract for service are two definite different things altogether, and the definition of same should not be mixed. A contract of service, let's say for example, is there is a relationship of a master and a servant which is implied in this and involves to obey the order in the work to be performed, and as to it is mode and manner of performance. This does not come with you, within the purview of the Consumer Protection Act. Thus, contract of service will not come under the Consumer Protection Act. So, however, the contract for service is something different. It implies a contract whereby one party undertakes to render services, which is professional or technical services, or for another in the performance of which he is not subject to detailed direction and control but exercises professional skills and uses his own knowledge and decisions. Thus, the difference between the two is one has a master and servant relationship. The other is a very professional kind of a setup where one is obliged to do certain amount of services, but we do not have any control and mode of execution of those service over the individual. Now, coming to the point of further another important point of the Consumer Protection Act, that is a deficiency in service. When do we actually approach? So deficiency in service as per the Act further means any fault, imperfection, shortcoming or inadequacy in the quality, nature and manner of performance that is required to be maintained by or under any law for time being in force or has been undertaken to be performed by a person in pursuance of a contract or otherwise in relation to any service is deficiency. Thus, we can approach in case the definition of deficiency is fulfilled by the respective vendor who is providing the services, and then they are not adequate in terms of, what we would consider in normal circumstances to be efficient services. Now, coming to the next leg of Consumer Protection Act, which is what is unfair trade practice. We can approach the court even in case of unfair trade practices. Also, if very vividly some of our listeners remember, I had put up in the tenancy law episode that, staying in a cooperative group housing society and deficiency in service by society of any nature would fall under these heads as I'm talking about them under the Consumer Protection Act. An unfair trade practice means a trade practice which for the purpose of promoting any sale, use or supply of any goods or services adopts unfair method or unfair or deceptive practice. Thus, as per the Act, the definition which it says has some of these practices which I'll enunciate. First is false representation. When any goods and services are not of stated standard quality or grade, then that is false representation. When, let's say, second-hand goods or any goods under renovation are sold, being sold as, as fresh or new ones or new goods, it is false representation. And when the respective seller does not have any kind of, you know, approval, affiliation, etc. with the brand which he's mentioning, that is false representation. When, you know, the goods or the service, like we have our advertisements where they show something else and it appears to be something else, that kind of a situation where they have claimed to be something but are not useful or do not provide the same benefit. And also the same products do not have the claim, warranty and guarantee as being displayed in the advertisements or otherwise on the product, it means there is false representation. Some of the other practices which are unfair is when the price of the product or the service is misleading. You know, when there has been a false or a misleading advertisement, as I said, you know, which is being selling at a bargain price, offering certain gifts, prizes, etc. in order to entice customers with no intention of providing them with any of these. Selling the goods which do not fall within the safety standards which have been set up by the competent authority. Hoarding, destroying goods with intention of raising the cost, as it happens in terms of crops, you know, milk selling, dairy other products where hoarders try to increase the price, or selling such products in over or excess quantity just as to manipulate higher prices, or manufacturing, you know, or offering such doubtful goods or adopting such deceptive practices in the provision of services. They all come within the ambit of unfair trade practices, which all of us in one or the other way in our life have gone through. The common example of it being the sale of Coke. And I said this previously in the episode as well. Selling Coke at 12 rupees, then the MRP at 10 is wrong. And also on the MRP, we are yet, as per law, we have been provided with this handle of asking to reduce the price of it. So MRP 10 doesn't mean he sells at 10. You have the right to bargain on the same. Also, something for all the listeners to be aware of while buying goods or any in terms of services, etc., are these three small points. If the seller respectively displays that goods once sold will not be taken back or no exchange or no refund in any circumstances, it amounts to unfair trade practice. It does not carry any legal weight. You can process in the court of law if you would want to and approach the Consumer Protection Act and go to the respective authorities at all of the levels, which I'll be taking further in the show. There are six forms of rights which are guaranteed by the Consumer Protection Act. Before I come to that, I like to take all my listeners through a small background of the Consumer Protection Act. India was averse to consumer laws and consumer rights from the advent of our constitution till the 1980s when the act came into picture. There was hardly much in terms of consumer protection. The world definitely had different type of laws protecting them. United Nations has different type of consumer laws and they started practicing the same in early 60s and 50s. Similarly, what is interesting to see is that in prehistoric and pre-Vedic times and monolithic times in India, under the Manusmriti and Kautilya, the most learned Brahmin had written all about consumer rights and they spoke about service, ethical service, how service should be provided. But all of this was absent and the socio-economic status of the country had gone down until 1986 when the government promulgated and enunciated the law and the act came out to be. And I was saying all of us, consumers need to be aware of such rights, you know. And the very famous logo, you know, Jago Grahak Jago is one of the famous ads run by the government to make everyone aware from the lowest strata to the highest strata. Coming to again to the point that, there are six consumer rights. First is right to safety. The right to be protected against the marketing of goods and services which are hazardous to life and property. Right to be informed. The right to be informed about the quality, quantity, potency, purity, the standard price of goods and so forth services to protect the consumer against unfair trade practices. The right to choose, which is the right to be assured, you know, whenever and wherever it is possible, access to a variety of goods and services at a competitive price, keeping into mind our economy and the nature and trend of the good. Right to be heard. Which means the consumer's interest will receive due consideration at appropriate times and at appropriate forums. Right to redressal, which is the Consumer Protection Act, which talks about granting the, you know, remedy. And of all the last, right to consumer education, which means be aware of all your rights. It is our right, to give you an example, it is our right to know the gross weight of a packaged commodity and demand a printed receipt fee of cost from the retailer dealing in packaged commodities. If we are not satisfied with goods and services of packaged commodity, we need to approach the consumer care and the details which are given on the package and report the same. If we do not do the same, we are not going to get the redressal. That's what the Act stands for. And believe you me, the Consumer Protection Act does provide you those remedies. The point of consumer disputes, redressal agencies. The Act specifically provides for a three-tier consumer dispute, redressal forum. First being District Consumer Dispute Redressal Forum, which is at district levels. State Consumer Dispute Redressal Commission at the state level and the National Consumer Dispute Redressal Commission at the national level. These are the three authorities as per which the Act is based. I spoke last time about when can complaint be made, and it remains the same in terms of who can complain, how it can be made. Just to refresh everyone's memory, a complaint may be made under the Act in writing under the following circumstances: when there is loss or damage caused to the consumer due to unfair or restrictive trade practices, the article purchased by a consumer is defective, the service which has been availed by a consumer suffers from deficiency, a trader or a service provider, as the case may be, has charged for the goods or the service mentioned in the complaint in excess of what was the stipulated or exhibited price, goods or services which will be hazardous in life and safety are being offered for sale to public. And coming to the point of who can file a complaint, any consumer, any voluntary consumer association, central and state government, one or more consumers, whether there are numerous consumers, a group of consumers or a society. In case there has been a death of a consumer, his legal heir or representative can do that. Where to file a complaint? Coming to this point, as per the Consumer Protection Act, the three agencies I mentioned, they are governed by the pecuniary value, which is like if the value of the claim is up to 20 lakhs, then you go to the district level. If the value of the claim exceeds 20 lakhs, but it is within 1 crore, you go to state level. If the value of the claim exceeds 1 crore, then you go to the national level. Apart from that, what is to be seen here is, in case the matter does not get resolved with any of these authorities, then they are challenged in Supreme Court, and Supreme Court is the ultimate authority to declare the judgment as to what will be the outcome. What has to be seen further is that the jurisdiction of the consumer forum. A complaint can be instituted, and it shall be instituted in a consumer forum within the local limits of whose the respective jurisdiction of the opposite party resides or carries out the business. Which means that in case wherever the individual has his office or a respective place of business, or where the deficiency has been committed, within that area, whichever is the consumer forum, there the party shall respectively file the complaint. Furthermore, area where, the cause of such an action, whether wholly or in part or in continuation, has arisen, that would be the point of filing of the respective complaint in terms of jurisdiction of the forum. There is a specific fee, I've been asked this question, is there any fee which is charged for filing the complaint? Every complaint which has been filed shall be accompanied by a fee which is specified, and it has to be in the form of a cross demand draft drawn on a nationalized bank or through a cross Indian postal order drawn in favor of the registrar of the state commission, payable at the respective place where the state commission or the national commission is situated. Now let me take you through what is the amount of fee payable in different situations. At district forum level, up to 1 lakh rupees for complainants who are below poverty line holding the Antyodaya Anna Yojana cards, there is no fee. Up to 1 lakh rupees for complainants other than the respective card holders, as I mentioned, would be 100 rupees. Above 1 lakh and up to 5 lakh rupees, it is rupees 200. Above 5 lakh and up to 10 lakh rupees, it is rupees 400. Above 10 lakh and up to 20 lakh rupees, it is rupees 500. Coming to the state commission, which is at the state level, above 20 lakh and up to 50 lakh rupees, the amount of fee payable is 2000. Above 50 lakh and up to 1 crore rupees, it is 4000. And national commission, which is above the state commission, above 1 crore rupees, if the amount is involved, amount of fee payable is 5000. Now, please don't be deterred by the amount of fees which are mentioned, because the district court takes into consideration all of these things and grants a very heavy and a rightful, justful and a judicious decision, where all of your costs are recovered and it is not neck to neck, cut to cut. It is to ensure that the consumer's rights are upheld. Is there a need to engage a lawyer for doing, or filing a complaint under the respective forums, as I mentioned? As per the Act, there is no need to engage a lawyer or any other pleader, and consumer can himself or through his representative file and represent his complaint. Some particulars which need to be furnished along with the complaint, I spoke about them in the last episode as well, but nonetheless, I'll reiterate again. The complaint should contain the following particulars, which is the name and the complete address of the complainant, the name and complete address of the opposite party, the date of purchase of goods or services which have been availed, amount paid for the above purpose, particulars of goods purchased with numbers or details of services availed, details of complainant, whether it is against unfair trade practices, supply of defective goods, deficiency in service, so forth, so on, etc. In case of excess of price, that has to be mentioned too. Bills, receipts and copies of connected correspondence, if any. Relief which is sought under the Act, what do you want in terms of relief? And the complaint should be signed by the complainant or his authorized agent. The time limit for filing the complaint. A complaint has to be filed within 2 years from the date on which the cause of action or deficiency in service or defect in goods arised. However, a complaint may also be filed after 2 years if the complainant can satisfy the respective forums in terms of deficiency and why he could not do so with sufficient reason. In terms of appeal, now let's look at when can we appeal. The provision for appeal is provided at all three levels. Aggrieved by the order which is issued by the district forum, appeal petition may be filed before the state commission within 30 days of the receipt of the order. In case of state commission, within 30 days with the national commission. And in case of agreed by national commission's order, appeal to the Supreme Court within again 30 days. Some of the reliefs which are available to consumers from the consumer forum. As I was talking about what reliefs can we look at, some of them I'll tell you about. Removal of defects from the goods, replacement of the goods, refund of the price which has been paid, removal of defects or deficiency in the services, award of compensation for the loss or injury suffered, discontinue and not to repeat unfair trade practice or restrictive trade practice, that can also be demanded, withdrawing of hazardous goods from being offered for sale, seizing of manufacture of hazardous goods and desisting from offering services which are hazardous in nature, issuing corrective advertisement to neutralize the effect of misleading statement and to provide adequate cost to parties. Furthermore, in case if the loss or injury has been suffered by a large number of consumers who are not indefinitely convenient, you know, identifiable conveniently, paying of such amount, which should not be less than 5% of the value of such defective goods or services, which shall be determined by the forum in agreeance with everybody in terms of audience and also the affected parties. Some of the acts which we should be aware of and in terms of helping us know our rights are, as I mentioned, Consumer Protection Act, the Legal Metrology Act, the Bureau of Indian Standards Act, the Essential Commodities Act, Prevention of Black Marketing and Maintenance of Supplies of Essential Commodities Act, National Test Houses and Consumer Cooperatives. We as consumers need to know what our rights are under these acts, and we should definitely look at their bare acts to understand and identify where we fall into and what would cover which. There is a respective nodal agency for consumer protection, which is the Department of Consumer Affairs, and it tightly functions, monitors each of these acts and also our rights under the same. It definitely also monitors the prices and availabilities of essential commodities, and we can report to the same in case we find discrepancy in our service, etc. Something also interesting for all of us to know is that there is a National Consumer Day which is being celebrated as well, which is on the 24th of December, as the Act was enacted on 24th December 1986. Who can you approach in terms of counseling, getting to know the right forum, where to apply, etc.? For all our listeners, there is a National Consumer Helpline on 1-800-114-000, which is being run by the government. It is guiding us, you know, all consumers in finding solutions to problems related to products and services. It provides information related to companies and regulatory authorities. It's a toll-free number. It facilitates consumer in filing complaints against defaulting service providers. It also provides consumers, you know, to avail consumer grievance redressal mechanisms and to see how the method operates. In case you would want to know how to go about it, it also spreads general awareness among consumers and their rights and responsibilities. In case there are any local languages and you would want to know the respective information in your local language, state consumer helplines are functional in the country. Not all, but yet most of the states, I would say about 22 states, have their respective numbers. These are available on the government sites where you can approach and definitely file your respective complaints through them. There is also a state consumer helpline knowledge resource management portal. It is an IT-based platform which helps in realizing and, you know, monitoring the respective state helplines. In the next episode, I would like to take this act further and cover up certain situations which all of us consumers face, which is related to, you know, how can we avail the benefit in terms of, you know, solving the dispute rather than going to the forums, that is mediation, how disputes can be resolved through mediation, what are the benefits of mediation, what is Grahak Suvidha Kendra, how can we check quality assurance, what are the different standards which have been, you know, prescribed for materials, is it mandatory for all manufacturers to adopt Indian standards? How do consumers definitely identify products, whether they conform to our EG mark or ISI mark or not? I'll be taking up all of these situations. And in case of a marked product, how do you lodge a complaint? We'll look at all of those situations and take that further. We'll also look at hallmarking in terms of gold and gold products. What is EG mark? What is wool mark? Who operates them? Who controls them? All of that in the next episode.
Thank you for listening to Know Your Kanoon. For more queries and questions, please contact me at contact@corpuslegal.in. Catch Know Your Kanoon every week on the IVM website or the app or anywhere you get your podcast from.
Hi, Hi listeners, we at Aditya Birla Sun Life Mutual Fund have come up with a special podcast series called MF 101 in collaboration with Bloomberg Quint. MF 101 is an informative series that will help you understand the recipe behind mutual fund investments. And what's more, it's coming from the chefs of the mutual fund buffet table, from the very own fund managers and analysts who are the manufacturers of the funds that help you realize your investment goals. New episodes out every Monday. You can listen to the show on the IVM Podcast app or wherever you get your podcasts.
Hey Meghnath, do you know how to citizen?
Hey Shreyas, do you know how to citizen?
Hey Meghnath, do you know how to citizen?
Hey Shreyas, let's just do a podcast about it.
Let's do a podcast about it. A podcast is called How to Citizen. In every episode, we get a new guest and discuss one chapter from the 8th grade civics textbook. Think about it as three friends revising before a test. And we go back to school. There's nostalgia, there's trauma, there are lunch breaks, there are favorite teachers, there are horrible teachers, there's everything.
So every Tuesday we bring in a guest on the podcast and we ask them a very simple question. Do you know how to citizen?
Meghnath, I think the question is, do you know how to citizen?
But Shreyas, I'm asking you this question. Do you